blinded by the light. Lots of puns, lots of double entendres tonight. Laura said in an email, you pick good titles. And you know, if you can't get a great photo, get a great title. It'll really help. So I wanted a bright screen because we're talking about light and yet we're talking about darkness as well. And while those have theological implications, they're everything for photographers because the way we handle the light and we manage the dark is how we get contrast, how we get shape and tone in our photographs, and essentially it's how we ply our trade. Welcome on behalf of the Kamloops Photo Arts Club, a group that's been together since, I believe, 1982. It was interesting to connect with the work of the Victoria Camera Club the other day. They've been around since 1944, so that's quite impressive. And tonight we are celebrating blind photography. And yes, that seems like a strange combination of words. As is my practice, I acknowledge that I'm calling in tonight from the territory where the speakers of Indigenous culture are both Lekwaman and Esquimalt. I acknowledge the presence within the boundaries of Canada of Innu and Métis and other cultures, those who have immigrated to these lands. We are a community together, and may we celebrate that in our photography. As they say locally here, Gia Kessler. Now we should sing, and I was going to play the song, and yet maybe I'll just sing my own rendition of the first verse. I can see clearly now the rain is gone. I can see all obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark clouds that had me blind. It's going to be a bright sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright sunshiny day. Kathy and I are hoping to travel from Victoria home to Kamloops tomorrow, and so we hope the rain is gone. We hope we can see all obstacles in our way, and certainly as a blind photographer, and I'll talk more about that in a minute, I personally have had lots of obstacles to deal with. Anne, who's on the call tonight, is totally blind. We work with the CNIB, and 8% of our client base are totally blind. That is, they cannot sense any detail, color, shape, or even light. Otherwise, there's a whole range of blind conditions, so-called blind conditions, which may appear obvious to the bystander, may not. So, for everyone, well, not everyone sees a bright, sunshiny day, but even if you lack visual acuity or peripheral or central vision or other obstacles, there can be brightness in life. Persons who live with blindness can do almost everything, not everything. I would love to have driven a car. I would love to have flown a plane. Oh well, I can at least take pictures of them. A little bit on blindness, just so we set the context, and this will be relevant. An estimated 1.5 million Canadians identify themselves as having a sight loss. In British Columbia, presently that number is 252,000. There are four leading causes of blindness in Canada. They're cataracts, 3,541,000 people. Often correctable, not in every situation. I've had one cataract corrected. It was amazing how great it looked after it was corrected. Age-related macular degeneration, the maculus of the eye deteriorates, creating general distortion. One way that that can be recreated is if you take some Saran wrap and you bunch it up and put that in front of your eye. That's the consequence demonstrated of macular degeneration. Glaucoma, portions of the range of sight are distorted or blocked out. You'll see some examples of that tonight. Blind photographers sometimes portray their own special vision challenge, and it's interesting to see the effects. Finally, diabetic retinopathy, something I've got to be careful of as I am now diabetic. That's where essentially the vitreous humor essentially distracts or totally obscures the light coming in through the lens, touching the retina and sending the image to the brain. What do I live with? It's albinism. Albinism is an inherited condition that leads to someone having very light skin, hair, and eyes. It happens because they have less melanin than usual in their body. Melanin gives skin, hair, and eyes their color. Except for vision problems, most people with albinism are just as healthy as anyone else. But, and this, I added this, it's the optic nerve, see? So the light comes in through the lens, and that's fine. It proceeds through the eye, and it touches the retina, and the retina doesn't have much melanin, and so there's all sorts of problems with the management of, as we would say, working in Photoshop, especially highlights. Then the signal is sent through the optic nerve, and there's a problem there, and we don't really know what's happening. So I only see part of what anyone else sees. We are famous, though, we albinos. Johnny Winter, died July 16th, 2014, just a while ago, was an American singer and guitarist. He was known for his high-energy blues rock albums and his live performances in the 1960s and the 1970s. A woman who is herself a professional photographer and a filmmaker in Ottawa did a feature film on him, showed it at the Eric Martin Pavilion at the Jubilee Hospital site in Victoria, and invited me to come out as a special guest. What a fun night that was. To the priesthood, William Archibald Spooner. 22nd of July, 1844 to 29th of August, 1930. He was a long-serving Oxford Don. A Don is essentially a professor. He was most notable for his absent-mindedness and for supposedly mixing up the syllables in a spoken phrase, you know where this is going, with unintentionally comic effect. Such phrases became known as Spoonerisms, and are often used humorously. Many Spoonerisms have been invented and attributed to Spooner. And the image of him looking close at his document on his standing desk, well, welcome to my life. When I was a layperson working from 1984 to 1987 in the parish of St. Andrews, Sydney, we had a descendant of Spooner in the congregation. Small world. Now, before I go any further into my last one, how are albinos treated in popular culture and in particular the movies? What do you think? Jump in, anyone. Are albinos good guys or gals, or bad guys or gals? You're all too scared to say anything. They're the villains. Do you remember the Princess Bride? And do you remember the albino? He doesn't even get a name. He's just known objectively as the albino. He ran the torture chamber. Da Vinci Code. Was it Cyrus or Silas? He was the kind of evil one who was obsessed with a rather brutal kind of punitive Roman Catholicism. We albinos do not do well in the movies. I do not apply. So here's my business card. I haven't used it for a number of years, and certainly I've got to redo it because there's pixelation in some of it, but it says Legally Blind Photography, and the tagline is, "We see what others miss." You're going to hear that phrase again in various ways tonight. And it is true. I do see what others miss. The downside is I often miss what others see. So clients, beware. I don't think I've ever sold anything. I might have in my lifetime maybe received up to $500 in commissions or wages. But anyway, and I kind of like the icon there too, where we've got a bright yellow sun with dark glasses on and a smile on the sun's face. Two questions I hear often, and they're totally understandable, both of these. What do I see, and what do I choose to photograph? To the first one, I can't really tell you what I see. And again, I was never in an accident. I never lost sight, so I don't know what you see. Based on conversation and comparison of experiences, I know that I see something different that you don't, and I know that you see lots of things that I don't. I tend to see in an image or in a three-dimensional setting, line, color, shape, and form. What I don't see is detail. So I do pretty well with architecture or flower photography, things that stay still. I do not do well with sports, which moves fast. I can't anticipate the action. Not so good at, say, competitive dogs. Not so good at nature photography or bird photography or any situation where I'm long, far away from the subject. It just doesn't work for me. So what do I choose to photograph? I got this question just a week ago. Well, you'll see it all has to do with patterns. So I was in a forest this afternoon at Royal Roads University, and there were all sorts of shapes and colors and such. It was all green. It's moss on moss here this time of the year, I can tell you. But it's the trees that draw my attention, or the flow of the stream. Am I alone in this? Well, let me tell you about Temple Grandin. Temple Grandin is world famous for being a high-functioning person with autism. But there's so much more to her than that. She invented a center track retainer system that half the cattle slaughtered in the United States and Canada pass through. The cattle will naturally circle around him because they have a natural behavior to go back to where they came from. The handler then should take advantage of this natural following behavior by waiting until the single file race has space in it before filling the crowd pen. And on the right, you see a very much a geometric drafting type document. She went out, and there's a movie about her life that shows this. And she was shown a great large pen of cattle, and they were traumatized. They knew that they had a strong sense that they were going to be slaughtered or sent somewhere they didn't want to go. She saw their movements in terms of patterns and determined flow processes and structures, which improved the management of cattle. She says in her own words, "Autism helped me understand animals because I think in pictures. Since animals do not have language, their memories have to be sensory-based instead of word-based. In my early animal behavior work, I noticed the cattle often balked and refused to walk over shadows or pass a coat hung on a fence. In the 1970s, it was a new idea to look at things that cattle were seeing. There is scientific evidence that animals think in pictures and that this learning is very specific." We'll come back to this as we're about to get into the images now. We think, or fully sighted people, or those who are sighted with the correction of lenses, think in visual terms. Blind photographers don't have that particular opportunity. But it was interesting talking with Shelley Joyce on CBC Radio this morning. At one point, you know, she was trying to figure out how blind and photographer went together. And she said, well, they go by intuition. And I said, that's great. That's right, because there's more than one way of taking the elements of a real setting, interpreting it, and transforming it into a two-dimensional image that still conveys a real expression of the data which was there in the first place, but is transformed. And it can be done visually, but it can be done with assistance of a sighted person. It can be done by hunch. Can even be done by sound and all sorts of other tactile ways. Before we go too far down the rabbit hole, I'm just going to share an item. Now, how do I get to that? That's interesting. Oh, here we are. I'm working off two screens, but sort of not. Here's a feature from CBC Radio. When I find it. There it is, but that's not the right one. Hang on. Uh, Here's a feature from CBC Radio or CBC Television in Saskatchewan about blind photographers. Can someone confirm, please, Kathy Gray or someone, could you confirm that you can hear the sound and see the image?
Rose Sarkany never let blind running marathons.
We're going to turn light in 1, 2, 3, right.
There we go.
Or from her favorite hobby, photography.
Okay. Okay. Do you want some buds? There's some closed buds.
Actually, all those the fluffy dandelions can be quite interesting. Mm-hmm. I've always been creative and artistic growing up because I see things that other people don't see.
But this is what I do.
Sarkany can only see a small tunnel of vision that will narrow as she ages.
With me, it's like with the viewfinder. That limited view through the camera is what I see. So it's actually, in my case, it's a good hobby to have.
Now, Rose Sarkany's passion is getting some public recognition. It's part of an exhibit that sheds light on the work of photographers who are all visually impaired.
From serene landscapes to feisty portraits, these images are as different as the people who snap them, but they communicate the same powerful message, say the exhibit's organizers.
A lot of people have the misconception that people who are blind or partially sighted live in complete darkness all the time, when in fact that's completely not true.
Advances in technology have certainly helped, from automatic focus to computer programs where shots can be enlarged before they're edited. Photography is more accessible than ever.
All right, here we go.
Ottawa-based Dylan Johnson is also part of the exhibit. He can't drive, but he has a thriving business as a professional portrait photographer.
It's not the first thing I lead with, because I probably scare a few people away if I tell them, hey, I'm a legally blind photographer, contact me. So the first thing I do to people is I show them my work, because, you know, quality work is, it trumps everything.
And having your work exhibited in one of the world's premier photography events can't hurt either. Deanna Sumanak-Johnson, CBC News, Toronto.
Just getting my PowerPoint back. I have to remember how to do it. It's on one. Okay. Or is it? Oh, I know. Right. Then I need to find my cursor. Okay. Tell me what you see. Do you see the PowerPoint? Someone? If someone could reply. Sorry?
It's good.
Okay. I want to introduce you to Ian Trim, Traherne. He is English, and he is an almost totally blind photographer. Similar to the first woman you saw in the video there, something like glaucoma. What we would call vignetting. And you could see with that woman we saw in the video, she had a little bit of central vision, and that was about it. She needed her friend or assistant to help her be pointed in the right direction, and then she could work from them. Ian sets up his camera with painstaking precision. The shutter clicks and he senses he has got the shot he wants. Despite being almost completely blind, he says he sees things that other people do not. Have you heard that before? I see past things, he says. I have always been an observer, an outsider looking in, but that helps me in photography. People often come to me at a difficult time in their lives where they are looking for something to change. It never ceases to surprise me that we do the shoot and then something amazing happens in their life. I like boosting their confidence. Completely self-taught, he is influenced by photographers David Bailey and John French, and also by his blindness. with their dark peripheries. His black and white portraits mimic his eye condition. I'm not going to lie, it is extremely difficult for me, he says. It is insanely hard working with this tiny window of light. And this I love. My view of the world is already cropped, but I have such a strong desire to see. So some portraits, almost in a film noir mode, subtle lighting. You see his own expression of his own condition in the lower part of the frame. Yet the top part of the frame, he can manage the entire frame, though he certainly would have to move from left to right and back again. He does a fair bit of portrait work. Interesting there, we've got a lot of the light back on the stairs, reflecting back on the subject, creating a bit of a hair light option. And again, he's not going for high contrast. It's subtle. It's his management, really, of the dark, which is his special gift. A burlesque dancer. From top to bottom, points of interest, the dress, the tattoo, the feather in her hair, one arm raised, the other gloved. There's a lot of detail in there. Images which are not what you would see in Vogue, but they are fashion statements. Oh, such a subtle, subtle image of a black person, shrouded in black, but the eyes sparkle. You can see the catch lights there. A woman on the streets of Berlin, a beggar, with the very busy fountain behind her, thrown out of focus slightly or blurred through a slower shutter speed. What's her story? He's a true portraitist. Person at a protest in Trafalgar Square in London. He looks burdened. It looks cold with the toque, the heavier clothes. Again, shallow depth of field, focus on the individual. There's depth and what we would call gravitas. Time magazine has had a number of foci, pun intended, on blind photography, and they have sponsored exhibitions. I have a half dozen images here with the artist's statement. And when I find my glasses, I can read them. As I said to Shelley this morning in the interview, you're going to see the Eiffel Tower in one of these cases in a way you have never seen it before. How often all of us try to find an image or a posture or a composition which avoids the obvious or the cliche. Annie Hess, Eiffel Tower. A perpetual wanderer, Hess has lived all over the world, a camera never far from her side. She says that she sees rough impressions, like Matisse at his vaguest, and only with one eye. She makes photos based on hunch, conjecture, and curiosity. In the chaos of a foreign place, she says, I might be attracted to something about the color or the sound or vague forms. I'll be right in front of it and not know what it is. So I'll capture it. And later I use the picture to figure out what it was that I saw. Remember for myself, line, color, shape, and form. A lot of what she says makes sense to me. Especially if I'm a distance away, even with magnification, I can't quite tell exactly what it is. So with digital processing, you just take a lot of shots and then you discover it in post-processing. Again, I might be attracted to something about the color. The second question, remember that I was asked, why do you shoot what you do? What is it that attracts you? And at the end of the day, what do you like shooting? I'll share some of my images at the end of our presentation, and you'll get a sense of what I enjoy looking at over and over again. Kurt Weston, Visor Vision. Kind of looks sci-fi, doesn't it? Of the works in Sight Unseen, the show's curator, Douglas McCulloch, writes, "For these artists, photography is the process of creating physical manifestations of images that already exist as pure idea, whether complex pre-visualizations that lead to eventual photos, or images imagined and triggered by non-retinal criteria." Hang on to that phrase. As such, the show poses an amazingly central idea that blind photographers possess the clearest vision on the planet. Well, the last statement is arguable. But what about that phrase, non-retinal criteria? Most of us see something, want to either make the image, capture it, take it, whatever, somehow contain it, package it for future use or sharing, or maybe even commercialization. It's the vision of the image or of the reality that we take as our starting point. The retina is involved. What is non-retinal criteria? A train is passing. In Kamloops, we're down at the bridge that is the walk bridge over top of the train lines. We hear the train coming. We know it might be fast or slow. It might be coming from left to right or right to left. We smell it. Maybe it's coal going towards the coast or oil or whatever. There are other ways of assembling a piece of photographic art which are not purely visual. It takes a lot of practice. And with the first photographer I mentioned here, you have to want to do it so bad that you're just going to try it over and over and over again. There is a collective, I believe it's based in New York. Yes, it's in New York, Scene with Photography Collective. Scene should actually be in quotation marks, scare quotes, or italics. I mean, how does one see? Laura and I have some fun conversations about this. Drawing on, I've forgotten the name of the author now. But anyway, the whole concept of seeing is more fluid than you might think. A group of blind artists based in New York, this portrait was made by the group using an updated form of a pinhole camera. The technique is simple. A pinhole camera in a dark room projects an image of an illuminated subject onto braille punched paper, and a digital camera is used to capture the result. I would need a video to fully understand how that process works. I attended a course at the Sorrento Center, which Michael Shapcott is the director of, a number of years ago on pinhole cameras. It was too much of a good thing for me, but again, a lot of visual photographic artists turn to unusual forms of capture to get more, they would say, imaginative or slightly abstracted or impressionist or expressionist results. You remember that, of course, from the masters of the, I guess, 17th and 18th and early 19th century, it was all detail, or detail was primary, and then came the impressionists. And we moved away from sharp lines, but all sorts of pastel colors. And I don't know as much of the history as some others of you will do. But in a way, these photographers are taking us in a similar direction. No longer like Sergeant Jack Webb used to say in Dragnet, nothing but the facts, ma'am, nothing but the detail. But we want a hunch, a reaction which is emotional and visceral to a real life situation. Alice Wingwall, interesting. Memory is the key ingredient here. Not always gathering data or assembling it from through the retina and the sight process. Memory. Though her images appear to be constructed of photographs, the primary building blocks of Wingwall's work are actually memory. Once an architectural history major, she lost her sight, gradually to retinitis pigmentosa. Now completely blind, she is the archivist of a private memory museum. Isn't that a wonderful line? The archivist of a private memory museum. Only after combining, reordering, and reimagining does she release a work into the world of the sighted. Though I've lost my sight, I haven't lost my vision, she says. Pete Eckert, Electroman. I love this. One of Eckert's techniques involves using a composite body view camera. I have no idea what that is. Mounted on a tripod. Focusing with notches carved into a focus rail, that's what moves the lens closer to or further away from an image, throws his studio into total darkness, opens the shutter, and roams the space, painting his image with light, using flashlights, candles, lasers, and other devices. A number of us in the club play with light painting like that. I have myself, and we should probably do some more of that because it's a wonderful tool. But my gosh, that is literally an electric picture. So, little bit less abstract now. Let's hear a news story from here in Victoria. And again. No, that's not what I want. That is what I want. Do you see the story? Vancouver Island baseball team hires legally blind photographer. Do you see that?
Yes, we've got it.
Good. Just have to get rid of the ad. Oh, shoot, it's going to play. Go away. The Vancouver Island baseball team has made history in hiring what is believed to be the very first legally blind sports photographer. Remember I said earlier I don't do sports? Well, this woman does. The Nanaimo Night Owls, the newest expansion of the West Coast League, have brought on Vancouver Island resident Angela, Angela Waldick, I think that says, to assist the team in capturing their photos. According to the team, the mother of two lost sight in her right eye 5 years ago, but despite this, she still runs a small business called Nightingale's Photography. After a household accident damaged her eye, Angela continued to pursue her passion for photography, which includes action sports as well as portrait and modeling photos. She will work closely with Victoria Harbour Cats team photographer Christian Stewart. Yes, Virginia, it can be done. I said to Shelley this morning that in 1975, I graduated from Oak Bay High. I had recently learned darkroom techniques, and I was the photographic editor of our high school yearbook. I loved taking pictures, but half of my pictures were out of focus. Autofocus as a technology was not widely available at that time. Viewfinders were very dim. I didn't have money for good equipment or didn't even know what good equipment was. Had I better sight or access to a different kind of environment, I quite likely would have pursued a career in photography because I love it. Well, this woman has found a way to make it part of her life in addition to parenting and probably some other endeavors. Good on her. I'm not sure if Alexandra Halliday made it on the call tonight, but she is a legally blind photographer living in Caslow. And I'm not sure if Mark Nickel made it on the call, but we're about to go to Mark Nickel and I'm going to introduce you to his work. But first of all, I'm going to go back to, do you see my PowerPoint again?
Yes, you see. Here,
yep.
And there.
Yeah. Let me introduce you to Mark Nickel. In his own artist statement, he says, "My mother has painted since I was a boy, and my father was a hobbyist photographer when I was young. In part due to my impaired, uncorrectable vision, Music became my creative outlet in my teens. In my 30s, I bought a pocket digital camera. Using the LCD screen on the camera made taking pictures viable for me, and photography immediately had creative appeal. Beside the opportunities photography provides to connect with people and to explore places and form, I delight in the imaginative, contemplative, and technical aspects of making images. This outlook inspires me to photograph broadly, and each subject that I portray, alive or inanimate, literal or implied, commercial or personal, satisfies many or all of these aspects of my craft. One thing that Mark really enjoys is dogs. Let me see, I don't know, I'll have to reshare. That's right, go to there. You know, the hardest thing, despite the fact I've made my cursor bigger, I put a tail on it, it disappears on me. There we are. Okay. There we are. Thank you. We've got some dog photographers in the club. A number of you. Don Garish is one. Brian Mitchell is another. Brian photographs often field dog trials and dogs in action. Do you see the picture of a dog?
Yes. Yes.
Mark does a lot of commissions. Mark works for the CNIB. He's an assistive technology specialist. He's been helpful to me over the years in various ways. He has a fine gift for dog photography. Hard to photograph a black dog, but he did it there. Black labs are hard, but he makes that one shimmer. Go low key. Make sure your background doesn't blow out the dog and you get a great image. Look at the sparkly eyes. Mark's condition is different from mine. I don't know the details of it. One thing I've learned in my work with CNIB in recent years is you can have three people with the same condition, and yet the experience, the challenges, and the opportunities can be totally different. I'm going to revisit some of Mark's work next week because he also does a lot with mobile phone photography. Isn't that something? Yeah. All right, I'm hunting for my cursor again. Of course, I'm working off my laptop with an extra monitor too, down since I'm not at home. That makes things a little more challenging. Ah, there it is. Good. I own this book, and if you're interested, I can loan it to you. It is the classic book on blind photography. And it is published by an architectural publisher, which is kind of interesting. The irony of the book is that it's set out in a font which I find almost impossible to read. It's too damn thin. Oh well, good try, everyone. You see the braille across the top there, or above the title, The Blind Photographer. Introduction, or the quote on the flip side of the title page, is from Stevie Wonder. It says, the best thing to do with stereotypes and preconceptions is to challenge them. And this book, The Blind Photographer, does just that. It breaks down barriers from both sides and shows what can be achieved if you turn your back on the doubters and just follow your dreams. Love this. Visions are not seen purely by the eyes, but through the spirit. As a former bishop of mine used to say, there's a sermon in there. But the book goes to the one question, how do they do it? This is the question most often asked by people when they first hear about photographs taken by the blind. The answer is much the same as that of the broader question, how does anyone take photographs? Do you hear the recurring theme? It's not just an exclusively visual process. And for those of us who might be stuck in an exclusively visual process, you can enrich that process by approaching your subjects, developing them, pun intended, beyond visual technology or techniques. The machinery of photography is fundamentally simple. It is designed to catch the image that light creates on objects by means of a lens and mechanical processes. These vary and develop in sophistication. The principle doesn't alter, though things are better with Fuji, just have to say. Being blind or sighted, having a camera, having a subject and a desire to make a visual image of it, the camera is pointed in the right direction and a button is pressed. Free as the breeze. Shoes. We should have a showcase, Crystal, on shoes. My wife has lots of shoes. I have one or two pairs. Got the whole world in your, yeah. Sometimes it's the simple things. We've looked at minimalism recently in landscape. You could look at minimalism in still life. Again, what do you choose to photograph? Are the items special? Or are they a special shape? We work on our own, but often people help us. It's necessary. For me, I need a driver because, you know, F8 and show up doesn't always work if you can't drive and independently get to a location. My wife once, we were down in Seychelles and there was a wonderful, heron. Well, of course, I couldn't see the heron until she pointed me in the right direction. And then I was able to take things further. We can work in teams and do so much more. So someone said to me, well, I'm really looking forward to seeing your images. And up until that person said that, I hadn't even thought of sharing any of my images, but you know, I probably should. So I've got a little video here, which might explain or set in context some of the things that we shared tonight. And when I find it, without any further ado, if someone could again, please confirm that you see the images and you hear the music, that would be fantastic.
Yep. There.
Yep. The imagery.
Do you hear the music?
Yes, Ken.
Yep.
Heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. You don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. Well, she tied you to her kitchen chair. She broke your throne and cut your hair. And from your lips she drew hallelujah. 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 I've seen this room and I've walked the floor. Used to live alone before I knew you. But I've seen your flag on the marble arch. Our love is not a victory march, it's a cold and it's a broken. Hallelujah. 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 Maybe there's a God above, but all I've ever how to shoot somebody who outdrew you. It's not a cry that you hear at night. It's not someone who's seen the light. It's a cold and broken. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
One final screen to share with you. Again, quotes from that book, Blind Photographers. Then we got some time for some conversation and an announcement or two, and then we're on our way. Some sighted people have become very skilled at manipulating the devices of light, measurement, the length of exposure, color, and tonal modification, etc. Some have not. But the huge number of possible uses to which photography has been put has taught us that the use of these technical devices does not necessarily increase the interest of a photograph or affect the value we place upon it. We, the sighted, look at photographs in 100 different ways. We look for different things for different purposes. We make judgments accordingly. So I'm hoping that our time together tonight gives you a little bit of a sense of the world in which I practice photo arts. I hope it encourages you in your own photo arts and maybe helps you go one step further.